sing praise to the Lord. Let every nation rejoice. All creation joins in the song. Valleys echo singing along. Mountains rise up loud and strong.
Jubilate,
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 Deo. Good morning. And what are we doing here? Nurturing people, body, mind, and soul for the glory of God. And what do we want to be? Faithful to God, grounded in love, and responsive to the world. Remember the responsive to the world part, because that's what we're going to talk about a little bit later this morning. Before we do, I have a couple of announcements. One is that we will be doing bag lunches after this service. So when the service is over, head down to the hallway and help us put lunches together. I don't know who did this, but we have a drop-off site out on Holly Street. And the reason we have that is for the Manor bus to park in. And when they can't park there, it makes other people late. So please do not park in the drop-off spot on Holly Street. Let's see. If you have a stewardship card and you haven't turned it in yet, please do so as soon as possible so we can make plans for next year. If you want to make an Advent wreath for your home, there's an announcement about that in the bulletin, but you need to sign up for that so we'll have enough materials that everyone will be able to make a wreath. And then in December, we're going to be doing, Doris Scholin's going to be leading a class on Christmas carols. That'll start the 8th, the 15th, and the 22nd. The 1st will be wreath making. So if you want to do wreaths, come in early on that day. And there's a deacon's benefit, and there's an announcement in the bulletin about that. Basically, they have been doing crafts, and they're going to be selling those since we can't really do a craft fair. Next Sunday, we have classical vespers at 5 o'clock with Teresa, who's playing for us this morning now. The Christmas concert is December 1st, and that promises to be very, very good. And then the Sarah Corson Christmas program on the 13th. Food of the month, all things Thanksgiving. All things Thanksgiving. So, except for the turkey. Don't have to bring a turkey. And I think that's all the announcements. Oh, we have a special congregational meeting coming up on the 24th for the purpose of elections for elder. Tam Moore has agreed to stand, and there are some other vacancies there, the Board of Deacons and the Congregational Nominating Committee. If you are interested in those, please let Patty Herkert know. Who else is on the nominating committee? Ann Lowe, Paulette, and they would be love to take your name. Oh, and Terry Johnson back in the back. So this is a sanctuary. This is, you know, in the old church times, if someone were falsely accused of a crime, they could go to the sanctuary. And as long as they had their hands on the altar, wrapped around the altar, somehow touching the altar, no one could arrest them. It was a safe place. We come here because it's a safe place. But we don't live in a state of sanctuary. We don't live there. We live in the world, and we have to engage in the world. That's what one of our things is responsive to the world. So as we go through this morning's talk, as we sing, as we share, think about what you can bring from here out there into the world.
please stand if you are able and join me in this morning's responsive call to worship. Jesus prayed for his disciples, giving them into God's eternal care. Know that you have been blessed with the love of the Savior.
We live in that love and seek to serve God.
Open your hearts and spirits now to hear God's word.
May our lives be open to God's Spirit and reflect God's love.
Amen.
First lesson today is taken from the book of Acts, the first chapter, verses 6 through 11. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took them out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven."
Thank you.
verses 20 and 21. Once Jesus was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God was coming, and he answered, "The kingdom of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, 'Here it is,' or 'There it is,' for in fact, the kingdom of God is among you." The word of God for the people of God. Every week we start the service here by me asking, "What are we doing here?" And by asking, "What do we want to be?" Faithful to God, rooted in love, and responsive to the world. Now, most people could talk about what it means to be faithful to God or rooted in love, but what does it mean to be responsive to the world? That's on our to-do list for this week, responding to the world. Now, in this sermon, I'm going to narrow it down a little bit because there are a lot of ways we are already responding to the world, feeding people, taking care of people, providing music for people, and I don't need to preach to the choir about that. But there's one thing that we need to talk about, and that is the nature of the church itself and the kingdom of God. Now, in our Presbyterian Constitution, which is called the Book of Order, there is a section that talks about the great ends of the church, the great goals of the church. This is our aim. This is who we ought to be. And one of them is exhibiting the kingdom of heaven to the world. If anyone wants to know what the kingdom of God looks like, they should be able to look at a church, any church, or the church universal, and see the kingdom. Now, we've just finished a major election, and it's understandable that when people hear the word kingdom, they think of church and politics. And given the fact that there is a lot of people out there talking about Christianity in politics, I guess one way to be responsive to the world is to look at what's going in the state of the church and in the state of politics. This week, we're going to look partially at what our relationship should not look like, and we're also going to look at what it does, what it should look like. Now, there are many ways to exhibit the kingdom of God to the world, but not all of them are biblical. Not all of them are true to what Jesus meant when he said the kingdom of God. For example, there is a movement called the Seven Mountain Movement, 7MM. Now, what is the Seven Mountain Movement? It started with a group of Christian leaders in the 1970s that designed what they called seven mountains, seven spears of society, identified as family, religion, education, media, entertainment, business, and government. And what they encouraged was that Christians take over all of these aspects of our society by force if we have to. The idea was not seriously considered until 2000 when a book was written called Invading Babylon. And by the way, America is Babylon, the Seven Mountain Mandate. Now, notice the language I've been using. Christians are to use force to take over these aspects of society. They want the country to live their version of the kingdom of God. Another name for this is Christian nationalism. And there are many different Christian nationalist movements. The Seven Mountain Movement is one of the largest, but not the only ones by far. American Christian nationalism is based on a worldview that America is superior to other countries, and that such a superiority is divinely established. It says that only Christians are true Americans. Christian nationalists believe that the U.S. was meant to be a Christian nation, that was founded as a Christian nation, but we drifted away, and now we need to take it back for God. And they talk about having to defend God, having to stand up for God, and basically taking the nation over for God. There are a couple of aspects to Christian nationalism. The first, as I said, America has been chosen by God for a special reason. We are the Christian light of the world. We were founded on Christian values, but we have lost our way. Making America great again means making America a Christian nation. Now, what that does to the masses of people who do not identify as Christians is left unsaid. But they are not so keen on the separation of church and state. They believe the church should reflect the values of the state, and the state should reflect the values of the church of Jesus Christ. Now, the second part of this is that God's will is being thwarted by demonic forces. And we can see that. We have no prayer in school. Gays and lesbians are allowed to marry. Abortion is legal, and the culture as a whole does not reflect the glory of God. All you got to do is watch television for about 20 minutes, and you can see that. Godly men, and in their understanding, only men should be running things, not ungodly people. They have no place in government. Now, that's changed a little bit with the advent of our new president-elect. He is seen as chosen by God by many Christians. They compare him to Cyrus, who became the king of Babylonia, and who not only allowed the Jews to return back to their homeland, he financed their way to it. And some believe that our next president is going to return us back to our homeland, that we would be a Christian nation once again. Yes, he is not perfect. After all, Cyrus was a pagan, but he is the chosen one of God that will make us a Christian nation once again. And finally, it is our call as Christians to take America back for God. Christian nationalists talk about spiritual warfare, because they believe that this is a battle against Satan himself. The soul of our nation has been corrupted by Satan and demonic powers, and we need to purify it. What do they want our country to look like? Many of them want the country to be much whiter than it is now. Many of the Christian nationalists are also white supremacists. Most of these movements believe God created a hierarchy with men at the top, and then women, and then children, godly men at the top. And that's the way families should be run, and that's the way our government should be run. Women have no place in determining the laws of the land or things like that. Their place is in the home, seeing to the needs of their man. Were I to suggest that to anybody that I have been intimate with, that would be the last thing I would say to them, probably. They believe God's law should be the law of the land. And recently, one of these people have come out and said that he belongs to a church that believes Old Testament law should be the law of the land. Now, I don't know how they're going to punish people for planting two plants side by side, which you're not supposed to do, or wearing two fabrics and the same set of clothing. I don't know if there'll be fashion police or garden police or anything like that. There's a lot of stuff in the Old Testament that I think we can safely ignore. It's funny how these people never talk about how we should not have barbecue and things like that. There's parts of the law that they're more than willing to ignore, but the other parts, they want to see our nation run according to the Bible. We see this in the recent movement in Louisiana to put the Ten Commandments in classrooms. As a historical document, I have No problem with that. But as a way to educate our kids, is it the school's job to educate our kids to put God first? Is it the school's job to maintain the Sabbath or to maintain obedience to parents? No, that's the job of the families. Now, many, if not most, of the Christian nationalists have embraced our next president as the person who will make us a more godly country. They see overturning Roe versus Wade as a start of a cultural movement that will bring us back to God. They have embraced him, and he has embraced them. Paula White, one of the leaders of the Christian nationalist movement, became the president's spiritual advisor during his last term, and she claimed that our president will play a critical role in Armageddon, the end of the world, as the United States stands alongside Israel in the battle against Islam. That's another thing they don't like, are Muslims. Charlie Kirk, one of the leaders of the movement and who was doing rallies around the country for our next president, has said, "We finally have a president that understands the seven mountains of cultural influence and will do something about it." Now, what's wrong with wanting our country to be more godlike? Nothing, if you go about it in certain ways. I believe we should all become more Christ-like, not just as a nation, as a church. We should all exhibit the virtues of Christ, the teachings of Christ. And do you think that Christ taught people that God loves me more than God loves you? That God loves me more than God loves a Mexican or a Haitian or a German? Do you think God loves the people of America more than he loves the people of other nations? Of course not. Of course not. God loves individuals. God loves the church of God. God loves those who seek to follow him. And God's love is there for all people. Do you think God loves a country more than God loves an individual? That somehow just being a good American makes you a good Christian? I've just talked about the misinterpretations of the kingdom, and now I'm going to switch gears. If we are to exhibit the kingdom of God to the world, what does it look like? First of all, Jesus is very clear. The kingdom of God is not a geographical place. At the very end of Jesus' earthly ministry, he's died, he's come back in the resurrection, he's taught his disciples, and in showing that they still don't get it, he's about to ascend into heaven, and they ask him, the last question they ask him is, "Are you now going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" They wanted the kingdom of God to be their nation, a geographical place. And the answer is no. It is not a matter of geography. The kingdom of God is not an earthly kingdom. When Jesus stood before Pilate, he said, "My kingdom is not of this world." The kingdom of God is not an earthly kingdom consisting of any one nation over any other nation, any one people over any other people. On the day of Pentecost, people from all over the known world were there, and God spoke to them in their own language. In other words, God welcomes all nations to the fold. No nation was chosen as a special nation blessed by God. The kingdom of God came to them all. Now, at that point, it had not gone to the Gentiles, but to show how inclusive the kingdom is, Peter takes the message of the gospel to a Gentile and has him baptized. Gentiles are not excluded from the kingdom of God. It is open to anyone who seeks to follow Christ in their life. In the gospel lesson, Jesus says the kingdom of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, look, here it is, or there it is. For in fact, he says, the kingdom of God is among you. That word can also, among, can be translated within. The kingdom of God is within you. The theologian Karl Barth was very insistent that the kingdom of God is not built up from this earth. That was the Tower of Babel. Instead, the kingdom of God comes down to us and resides in our hearts. The kingdom of God is not about power. The disciples were walking down the road one day, and they started talking to each other about who gets to sit at Jesus' right and left hand. In other words, who's going to be at top of the power structure? Now, if you've ever been a part of a political campaign, you know that that is a very common thing. People work for candidates so they can have a job in the candidate's office. That's to be expected. That's the way it works in the world. That is not the way it works in the kingdom of God. Jesus shut that conversation down very quickly. He says, you know that among Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them. And the great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. Instead, whoever wishes to become great among you must also be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be the slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. I sometimes hear Christians talking about having power over others, and if you hear that, you can rest assured they are not talking about the kingdom of God. Those who are great in the kingdom of God are those who serve, not those who wield the most power. The kingdom of God is about the character of the people who inhabit it. It starts with our inner virtues, our inner way of relating to God. Many different places in the Bible refer to the character of those who should be followers of Jesus. Paul mentions the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things, he says. You cannot legislate these virtues. You cannot make someone gentle. You cannot make someone faithful. And I can't even make myself be patient, much less other people. Those who use hate as a weapon are not a part of the kingdom of God. For our call is to love God and love our neighbors. Now, that is not to say that Christians should stay out of politics altogether. Oregon had a very godly man as a senator, Mark Hatfield, who did a wonderful job, I think, balancing the demands of the kingdom and the demands of his job as a U.S. senator. You know, he didn't try to lord his power over other people. He really tried to serve the people. And there are many others who have served in local places, in state houses, in national view, who really are Christians who are trying to do their best to serve God given the jobs they have. So I'm not against all politicians and all politics. But the kingdom of God is not legislated. It can't be. In the kingdom, the less fortunate are taken care of as if they were the king himself. And I think we do a great job of that here. Jesus gave a parable In Matthew 25, he says, "All the end days, all the nations will be gathered before the king, and he will separate people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. And then the king will say to those on his right hand, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.'" Why? "Well, I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." And the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty and give you food and drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you? When did we see you naked and give you clothing? When was it that you were sick or in prison and we visited you?" And the king will answer, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it for one of the least of these brethren, brothers and sister of mine, you did it to me." The king identifies with those who are downtrodden. In the end, being in the kingdom of God means following the one king, Jesus, who does not reign with power, he reigns with love. If someone is claiming to represent the kingdom of God, but you have a hard time finding love in the mix of what they're saying, they are probably not representing the kingdom of God. Now, we shouldn't stick our heads in the sand and ignore what's going on around us. It's just that we need to approach the world as Christians, as people who are bound to the love of God, as people who love their neighbors as themselves, as people who show the character of what it means to be a person of God, a member of God's kingdom. In the early church, they were early Christians, took care of one another and took care of the people, and they were so popular that when the equivalent of the police were sent to arrest Christians, they refused to do so because they were afraid they would start a riot. One of the pagan philosophers of the day said about Christians, "Behold how they love one another." God does not need political power to get done what God wants done. In China, before the Cultural Revolution, it was estimated that there were about 30,000 Christians. And then they went through the Cultural Revolution, which, if you don't know what that is, the Chinese government wanted to change the entire culture. And that meant, among other things, persecuting Christians, persecuting them strongly. And those Christians who had been watching China, who had been missionaries in China, who cared about Chinese Christians, were afraid that when the revolution was over, they would come into a country where there were no Christians. Well, the Cultural Revolution ended. And what they found was not 30,000 Christians, but 3 million Christians. They flourished under a repressive kingdom. They grew because God was their king. And that's who they followed. We will not see the kingdom of God fully realized on this earth. As Jesus said, his kingdom is not of this world. We engage with the world. We're responsive to the world. We interact with the world. We live in the world. This is God's world, and we're not to hide from it. But we are not to let the world form us into what it wants us to be. That is God's job. Amen. Peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace of Christ one with another.
Lord, prepare.
please join me in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are our King, and we follow you. But you're a King unlike any other King in the world. Your kingdom is based on love. Your kingdom is based on joy, on hope. Your kingdom is based on those things that cannot be produced by any bills or legislation, cannot be produced by the entertainment industry or business or government. You are the King of the kingdom of God, and we are the members. Help us to be faithful to your kingdom. You have called us to be good citizens where we are, to pray for our leaders, and may we do that. You have called us to engage with the world around us, and may we do that. But also, help us first and foremost to engage with you and your love, and to spread that love to others. One of the ways we spread love to others is by praying for them. And now we lift up people who have prayer needs to you at this time.
Lord, we lift up Andy and Kathy Ulrich, who are not feeling well today, that ask that it would be something minor, and they would be back with us in the church this coming week. We pray for Bill and Mary Lynn's friend Barbara, who has lung cancer and will have surgery next week in Portland. For Barbara Gursky, who's facing kidney surgery. For Ellen's brother-in-law, Doug, whose leg was amputated last week. We thank you, Lord, for all those who have felt God's healing touch. All that we should be thankful for, that we would be thankful for in this season of Thanksgiving. We thank you that Sue's brother-in-law, Dennis, is now recovering at home from medical complications. We thank you, Lord, for the abundant rain and the beauty of the season. And now, Lord, we ask that you would hear the prayers and the joys of those who would come and light a candle and share their hearts' burdens or joys.
For your cousin Kathy, who's on hospice now.
Celebrating birthday.
Lord, in your love and mercy, we bring these prayers before you in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now the ushers will wait upon you to receive your tithes and your offerings.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you for all the gifts that you've given us, and now we return a portion to you for the building up of your kingdom of love for your glory. Amen. First, I want to remind you that we're doing sack lunches, so when worship is over, head down the hallway and help assemble bag lunches for the duration of this week. Go out into the world. Go out into this world that God created and bear the love of God to that world. God doesn't need us to defend him. God needs us to love him and to love others. And may the love of God fall upon you like a soft summer rain. May the grace of Jesus surround you like the air you breathe, and may the power of the Holy Spirit work in and through you now and forevermore. Amen.